I'm on a rental kayak. They ran out of seats.
All right, let's go.
To see a ship made of concrete. Actually, 9 of them. I want to start this video with a game. This is Richard Lewis.
I've been permanently banned from trying to update Wikipedia after a huge argument with them over the concrete ship page.
I want you to guess what number he says here.
I've identified a concrete ships worldwide.
Concrete ships, like this one being built, or the launch of this one. They are ideas that seem crazy, but might actually be crazy genius. Learning about concrete ships changed my understanding of engineering and design.
Can you just tell me a little bit about how this, what I might call an obsession, started for you?
I actually look across Carlingford Lock, across to Northern Ireland and the Mourne Mountains. So we have a marina. In the center of the marina is this big black ship. So I just asked the marina owner, what's the story with this ship? And he said, it's made of concrete. To which I responded, sorry?
These massive projects took place across decades and around the world.
And I met a friend from Norway called Erlend Bonderud. And between us, we established a website called thecretefleet.com. Between us, Erlend and I have identified over 1,800 concrete ships worldwide.
But let's pick one specific build to zero in on. Zoom into Tampa, Florida today, and you can see an historic shipyard still in operation. This was the home of the McCloskey shipyard, where 24 concrete ships were built in 1943 and 1944. We're gonna see how many of these we can track down today. Okay, so slight change of scenery here. You might be wondering, why is Phil not in his office anymore? I texted my friends that this company was sponsoring me and they were like, I am happy for you. And that's because the sponsor of this video is 8 Sleep. They've just launched their latest product, which is Pod 5. I'm gonna show it to you. You put it right on top of your normal mattress. As you can see, it looks beautiful. And the cool thing is it regulates the temperature separately on both sides of the bed, making it hot or cool as you need to get a good night's sleep. I called it Podsworth the Bedtime Butler because that's what he does. It's kind of automatically regulating stuff. I wanna show you my sleep report too. It gives me a sleep fitness score, because in addition to regulating the temperature, it is figuring out how well I am sleeping. I actually pushed back this video a week so that I could really test this thing out and see how it made a difference. I'm gonna say my favorite things, the wake up, like being woken up gently, is actually really helpful to get my day started. So go ahead and head over to the link that I've put in the description or use the QR code. Make an investment in your sleep. It is a big part of your day, right? You can get $350 off the Pod 5 Ultra if you use those links. You can try it out for 30 days. If it's not for you, you can send it back, but I think you are gonna like it and you're gonna realize that it changed your sleep. They ship to a lot of countries worldwide. There's more details at the link, but yeah, give it a try. Thank you to them for sponsoring this video, and let's go ahead and get back to it.
They built 24 ships in 14 months.
Yeah.
Which is a remarkable achievement. Yeah. The replication of a standard design.
The standard design for the McCloskey concrete ships was this. A self-propelled concrete ship. These are the designs. 24 were made, each named for a different engineering pioneer, like a geologist or hydraulics engineer. These self-propelled concrete ships are actually kind of rare. You see, they're less nimble and slower, so it was more common to have barges that were towed or tugged along. One of the Powell River concrete ships is more typical. It's a barge with no propulsion. It was built in San Francisco, California. But this was not just a World War II thing. The Peralta, seen here, was a World War I era concrete oil tanker. But the why behind all these vessels, despite their different time periods and purposes, that is actually pretty connected.
It seems like the vast majority was driven by scarcity.
Why did we have two eras of concrete shipbuilding? Raison d'etre of all of this is a scarcity of steel. You can't get away from that. During wartime, ships are being sunk by U-boats, meeting their fate for all sorts of reasons. There is a shortage of steel because steel is now in demand, not just for ships, but for pretty much everything to do with armaments, et cetera, et cetera.
That was the reason for so many scrap drives. They were directly tied to ship construction. And concrete was seen as a possible stopgap during World War I and World War II. Concrete ships were the best idea within constraints. Look at the construction process. These ships still had steel frames, almost like a skeleton. The steel made them viable. It reinforced them. Just look at the deck steel in place in another shipyard, waiting for concrete. I think that this popular science illustration from the time shows the best graphic. Wood on the outside was the concrete form. They poured concrete around the steel, then just stripped the wood away, leaving a boat just like a Play-Doh model. And it wasn't like this was solid concrete. Look at this chart for the design that we're tracking, the C1SD1. This is the shell thickness. It's 6.5 inches. These ships weren't super cheap either. As this table shows, our ships were about $2 million each and the facility cost $5 million. Inflation calculations are kind of weird to compare during wartime, but imagine $35 to $40 million today. The McCloskey ships were launched from a basin and it wasn't seamless. Here you can see the Talbot, which was damaged at launch. The first three all suffered damage at launch. They had incorrect ballasting. Basically, incorrect ballasting means that they weren't weighted correctly at launch, which is important because concrete could crack so easily. Ships like these moved cargo, like sugar, and refrigerated barges had novel purposes, including ice cream barges made of concrete. So these ships weren't nimble attackers, they were workhorses, meant to do the work of carrying lots of cargo from place to place. But what's really fascinating is, what do you do with these ships when moving cargo is no longer a priority? Steel ships were salvaged. Even American enemy steel was used for scraps. But what do you do with the concrete ships? It's hard to get the steel out of there, and this is where things get really creative. Our first seven McCloskey ships ended up here, the Powell River breakwater in Canada. But how did they get here? And why were they made? Look over here. Do you see the logs? A paper mill needed a spot to float logs before they were milled. And that stroke of genius is where the next nine boats come in.
Nobody wanted these concrete ships. Okay, they tried, the government tried in the kind of a bid process on two occasions.
Off Kiptopeke State Park in Virginia, nine concrete ships still sit and still kind of perform the purpose that got them there. You see, this enormous bridge didn't exist at the time. I drove over it, it's insane. So at the time, a ferry was a great idea to speed up the crossing, and a breakwater would help them do it safely. Across the world, these concrete ships have served as breakwaters, but Kiptopeke is a perfect example of how this happened internationally. I actually learned a lot by getting to kayak up to these ships. The most interesting thing is you can see the steel forms beneath the concrete.
Look at that, that's cool.
They arrived as fully fitted ships with masts and all sorts. And then basically it said that all the things kind of disappeared. Now, whether they were sold or whether, apparently a lot of local houses have got doors that were on those ships and they've got plates that were from those ships.
Less glamorously, two ships in Oregon were sunk for use as docks, only to be largely replaced over time. One ship sank en route to that spot. Others were lost at sea. Two were scrapped in the South Pacific. Exact location, unclear. Another was sold to the Mexican government, sold again, and then sunk off the coast of California. That leaves two ships that traveled from the McCloskey shipyard in Tampa to another final destination, off the coast of France.
Can you describe what those two ships did during D-Day?
When the US was looking for the ships needed to create these gooseberry breakwaters, yes, individual ships were known as corn cobs, the collective was known as gooseberry, they were designated to become that. They actually came over to Milford Haven, which is in Wales, first of all, at which point it was decided that they would be sacrificial. There are over 70 ships that were needed because there are five gooseberries, because there were five landing beaches. There's obviously Utah, Omaha, which everybody knows, Gold, Sword, and Juno. and each had a breakwater to calm the waters the other side. The gooseberries really were block ships, and then there were things called Phoenix caissons, which were these huge monolithic 6,000 ton blocks of floating concrete that were then sunk in position. Now, say the why a ship was chosen to be a block ship, it could simply have been its age. So there were pre-World War I ships. It could have been damaged, you know, during a battle. It could have been defective. In order to be sunk. And so they were sunk in a line, five lines to be more precise. And because they're concrete, they're still there.
So why make this video? I mean, I only covered 24 of the 1,800 ships that Richard and his co-authors have found. For Richard, the reason is probably the stories that come from the concrete ships more than just the ships themselves.
It doesn't ever end with the concrete object. It only begins with the concrete object.
For me, having been a tourist for a couple of weeks in this world, it's got me thinking about creativity and constraints. After the concrete ships, McCloskey built steel ships like these. Steel ships were better. They were faster, they were more stable, they were usually lighter. The Liberty ship became the iconic World War II ship, twice as fast as concrete, better too. If you'll bear with me, I've been rereading Moneyball. It's a book about how a poor baseball team had to resort to outside-the-box thinking, counterintuitive thinking, to compete. Instead of choosing an obvious superstar, they had to assemble the best they could from what they could afford.
Just recreate him. Recreate him in the aggregate.
It's a book about a type of creative genius working within constraints. In concrete ships, they are kind of a type of money ball. They didn't labor under the illusion that this was the ideal material, but it was an available material, and they made it work to help deliver cargo, and then they were able to reuse it really creatively to help in a lot of different ways. And the nice thing about concrete is that we can still see evidence of that creativity in a river in Canada, or near a beach in Virginia, or on satellite images of another beach off the coast of France. Hey, that's it for this one. Thank you for watching. This was super fun. I got to go on a kayak. Now, listen, if you criticize my kayaking style, they did not have a seat, and I had to hold a camera and do all this other stuff. So hold your fire, okay? That's all I'm going to ask of you. If you don't know, I've got a newsletter that I put out with each video. It's totally free to sign up for. You can sign up on Patreon. And when you do, you find out when I have a new video come out, and you also get an extra article that is something that I couldn't fit into the video proper. And this time, because I chose such a narrow frame for this video of these 24 ships, I want to give you some of the highlights and a little more information about the Crete Fleet from my discussion with Richard, because it was fun to talk to him about it, and there is so much more that we could have gotten into. So yeah, that will be the feature this week. Otherwise, let me know if you think that these concrete ships were kind of genius. If I'm overusing the word, do you think I'm kind of clickbaiting you there? I really don't think that I am, but it took the Moneyball connection for me to figure that out, how I could justify it. So yeah, I'm curious what you'll think. And otherwise, thank you for watching, and I'll see you in the next one.